Hi, I'm Ben Mankiewicz, host of The Plot Thickens and Turner Classic Movies. We wanted to bring you some of our favorite moments from Peter Bogdanovich's archive. If you've been listening to The Plot Thickens, you know that Peter started recording interviews with some of classic Hollywood's greatest directors in the early 1960s. These are really the conversations where Peter learned his craft, learned how to be a movie director. The first one, from April of 1972, is with Howard Hawks, the director of Red River and Rio Bravo, among so many others. At the time of this Hawks conversation, Peter was 32 years old. He'd already directed The Last Picture Show. His next movie, What's Up, Doc?, was a modern screwball comedy, drawing much of its inspiration from screwball comedies from Hollywood's golden age, like His Girl Friday and Bringing Up Baby, films directed by the master of the screwball comedy, Howard Hawks. We hope you enjoy it.
This is the desert outside of Palm Springs, California. It's about 2 hours' drive from Los Angeles. Howard Hawks lives here in Palm Springs when he's not making pictures. You can hear him in the background. He's riding the dunes with his son, Greg. Here he comes now.
Hi, Peter.
Hi, how are you?
Fine, thank you. You know my boy, Greg.
Yeah, sure. Hi, Greg. How are you?
That's quite a thing you built.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a little bumpy, but I mean, it does the job. Yeah.
Well, if you want to talk, let's sit in that thing.
Come on, let's
shall we?
Yeah.
Well, Pete, start asking questions.
All right. I know that often a whole picture, a whole idea for a picture is born from your reaction to another film or another story. Isn't that the way Rio Bravo came about?
Yes, Rio Bravo really started because I had seen a picture called High Noon, where the sheriff, played by Gary Cooper, went around begging everybody to help him.
I guess you all know why I'm here. I need deputies. I'll take all I can get.
You must be crazy coming in here to raise a posse.
My idea of a sheriff is a professional who doesn't want amateurs butting in and wants to do it by himself. And so, actually, Rio Bravo started that way. And it was made possible by John Wayne just simply saying, stay out of my fight. Let me handle it.
Yes.
You'd just be a lot of nuisance that I'd have to take care of. And that was the attitude that he had. And it led to a pretty good story.
I was talking about why you hadn't asked for any new deputies. You could get some, you know.
Here.
How about my drivers? You could use them.
Suppose I got them, what did I have? Some well-meaning amateurs. Most of them worried about their wives and kids. Burdett has 30 or 40 men, all professionals. Oh, Pat, all we'd be doing is giving them more targets to shoot at. A lot of people would get hurt.
Marvelous thing in Rio Bravo at the end when John Wayne says to Angie Dickinson, he's, I'll arrest you, and she says, I thought you'd never say it.
Say what?
And he says, say what, you know, and he said, that you love me. I didn't say I loved you, I said I'd arrest you.
It means the same thing, you know that. You just won't say it. Oh, we're different. I'll have to get used to you.
The characters in your pictures often say the opposite of what they mean.
Peter, we call that, or I call it, three-cushion dialogue. I believe Hemingway called it oblique, and Noel Coward used it, and he had another name, something like carom for it.
Yeah.
And all it means is saying something, but going around the bush when you say it, and not be direct.
Mm.
And it's a very, it seems to be very popular, at least the audience to put their own interpretation of the thing, and it works out very well.
There's a certain ambiguity to it always.
Yes, and then also you don't feel as though you're hearing the same thing all over again.
Mm. In El Dorado...
You know, before we start in on that, how about getting in some shade? It's pretty hot out
here. I'm glad you said it.
Yeah, this is cooler and better, isn't it?
Yeah, a little bit. I'd like to ask you some specific questions about some films, but I'd like to begin with El Dorado. There's a scene at the end when John Wayne and the villain have a showdown, And unlike most showdowns in the Western, there's a respect between the two men that's very clearly defined throughout the whole picture.
There's a little question unanswered between us.
Which one of us is best?
That's right.
And you did that in your first talkie in the Dawn Patrol, with the English flyers and the German flyers having great respect for each other. Something goes through your work.
Peter, that is a way of saying that somebody is good when other people have respect for them. You don't have to go to a lot of foolish lengths to show that they're good. Somebody who's good says the other person is good, he automatically becomes good.
Oh, that's the man that brought you down.
That's my ganz großer Ding. Das freut mich aber sehr. Du bist mein Freund. Verstehst du?
What's he say?
As mein Freund.
I don't know.
Right.
He just wants him to have a drink.
Oh, drink. Drink. But drinks.
I think the best scene in Dawn Patrol, when they all sing the song, Hurrah for the Next Man Who Dies, you know. How'd that scene evolve? Do you remember?
After the war, my brother and I met a little fellow who was standing with a ring of waiters around him, and he called a waiter a servile son of a bitch, and I rather liked him for that. And anyway, they knocked him down, and a waiter hit him, and my brother hit the waiter, and pretty soon there was a mess, and we were going to go to the jail. And I said to the cop, "You gonna say that little guy gave you that eye?" And he said, "Can you get rid of him?" And I said, "Sure." And he taught my brother the song.
This is your brother Ken.
Yeah, so we remembered it. And I did it. And then was terribly surprised to find out we'd stolen Rudyard Kipling's poem. Nobody told me.
Oh, it's a poem by
It's Kipling. A poem by Kipling put to a Yale song.
Did you get in trouble?
Thank God, no.
It's a great song.
It's a good song.
Oh.
We meet beneath the sounding rafters.
We meet beneath the sounding rafters.
The walls all around us are bare.
The walls all around us are bare.
They echo the peals of laughter. It seems all the dead are there.
It seems all the dead are there.
So stand by your glasses steady, this world is a world of lies.
So stand by your glasses.
I don't know why I can steal and remember all the lines.
The other thing you do in Dawn Patrol that you did in a lot of your pictures is that you never really show the outside world. In other words, they go off to have some drinks and go out in bars, but you don't really show that. You only stay within the sort of enclosed world of that is their life. Well, why did you do that? Is that a sort of to give a feeling of unity to the story, or just to keep it claustrophobic? Because you did that in Only Angels Have Wings, too. You never really go away from that.
You've got
area.
People are watching. Why get them out in some strange, you know, strange place? I don't believe it. Not if you've got a good story. If you've got a bad one, that's the place to go.
Just stay where the action, just stay in town. Stay wherever it is.
What the hell did you do in the last picture?
Yeah, I know. I didn't ever leave that town.
You never went off to war? You never went to anything?
No.
You know?
No, we had a scene where they go off to Mexico. And we took it out because it didn't need it. It didn't seem to me to be right.
Hey, we go to Mexico. Be back sometime Monday.
You reckon to pick up and make it?
Yeah, mind. How much money you got?
Oh, 30 bucks, about.
Well, I got 40. We can make her in that. Come on.
Okay.
On the set, do you design your set, do you design your shots or plan out your sequences in any way other than in your mind?
No, we never make a plan or anything. Just, I get a look at a set few days before going into it, and by the time I've gone into it, I know exactly what the sequence is going to look like, where the camera is going to be, and in general, and where the cuts are going to be and everything. I find it almost impossible to make a sequence unless I know ahead of time what it's going to be like.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't, that knowing of it isn't something that you write down or figure out on paper. It's just something that...
Oh, just something.
You see in your head.
In a picture called Hatari, we had an idea, and I could see a net going over a tree where there was 1,000 monkeys in the tree. And I asked the special effects man if he could do that, and he said, "You really mean what you're saying?" And I said, "Yes." And he spent $40,000 before we started the picture trying to make a net go over a tree that had 1,000 monkeys in it. And by the time we got ready to shoot it down in Africa, he was a shaking wreck. He postponed it 5 days because he could feel a whisper of wind. He didn't want any wind. And it worked beautifully the very first time.
I'm going to shoot that net over the tree. There are monkeys in the tree, at least 500 of them. You worry about catching the monkeys, okay? That's your job. I'll be standing right here watching you.
It worked. Pockets, it worked.
Didn't you have something similar in Rio Bravo where you wanted to blow up that house where all the villains were at the end, and the first time you blew it up, something went wrong?
Oh, the first time we blew it up, we had a great big charge, and they had a lot of colored paper, and it looked like a Japanese fireworks going off. We had to do it all over again. That meant we had to build the place again. And but that worked out all right, finally. Nobody knew that that was going to go up in the air like that.
Can't you throw them any farther than you have been?
Of course I can't if you want to blow the whole place down.
That's a general idea. Throw it.
That got him. That took the fight out of him. Look at him quit.
Your pictures are darker than most people's films. The lighting is darker. Even the comedies, which most people lighten. You make the darkest comedies.
You'll find that the backgrounds are darker, but the light on the faces is just about the same. Mm-hmm. That's just a method of lighting is all. Mm-hmm. It's the ability to use lighting where you can see the faces of the people, and yet you don't have to get it that full light that is usually associated with comedies, which isn't exactly true. Mm.
Well, it's interesting that, you know, bringing up Baby, particularly the chase at night after the bone and the leopard, is lit, you know, almost like a drama.
Well, it is a drama. It's a drama that happens to be funny, that's all. They were chasing a leopard, and that should be fairly dramatic, even though it's funny.
I can't see a thing.
Neither can I.
Susan, are you sure you saw something moving here? Because I can't... Well, Susan, where are you?
Here I am.
Susan, this is no time to be playing squat tag.
I'm not playing.
The dramas deal with men in danger, and the comedies really deal with a man in an insane world, because the pace of your comedy is so fast, and there's something almost demented about the world that the man finally finds himself in, particularly, for instance, bringing up Baby. Katharine Hepburn's world is totally daffy, and the 20th century, you picture the world of the theater as one of almost insanity.
There's no way of at all of setting up a criterion for a thing like that. You read a story, you think it's funny, and you think it'd be fun to tell it, so you tell it. And it isn't done consciously at all.
You once said to me that there was one thing wrong with bringing up Baby, and that was that there wasn't any character in it who was sane.
There was no sanity. Everybody was rather insane, and I thought the picture suffered because of that. And never did it again, and always had sanity to show how insane the other people were. There was no measure of in bringing up Baby. Other stories that worked out much better because of having perfectly normal people. That's the only way that you can show abnormality is by having
by contrast.
I've made a mess of everything, haven't I?
Oh, no.
I was so happy when I found the bone this morning. Oh, David, if I could only make you understand. You see, all that happened because I was trying to keep you near me, and I just did anything that came into my head.
Well, let's talk a little bit about His Girl Friday. I know how you have all that overlapping dialogue that you did earlier in... Well, even in 20th century, I suppose it was the first place you really did it, isn't it?
and then in bringing up baby.
Well, it was pretty, His Girl Friday, the dialogue was particularly adaptable to that. And I'd noticed that people talked and talked over one another, and especially people who talk fast and were in a quick argument or quick description. So we wrote the dialogue in a way that left the end of the sentence so you didn't need it in the beginning of a sentence, and we just kept them overlapping. Mm-hmm. And any new actor that came in took them a couple of days to get oriented and going. Everybody put up with that, and then it worked beautifully from that time on. It's a very natural way.
Oh, yeah. Around here, man, can look at it without shuddering.
Listen, Walter.
Listen, I made a great reporter out of you, Hildy, but you won't be half as good on any other paper in New York. We're a team. That's what we are. You need me, and I need you, and the paper needs
both Americans.
Did you have to buy the rights to the front page from Hughes?
Yes.
In order to make it?
Yes.
The original front page, the movie, is supposedly not very good. Is that right? It's not as fast as yours,
I don't know, but Peter, at the time that it was made, newspaper men, for them, that was a milestone in pictures. You know, it was they liked it. And it got great reviews and was said to be so terribly fast, so that when I was making, got about halfway through, and three or four newspaper men who had come out talked about the speed of the first one. I fixed up a little thing where on two projection machines we ran part of the old one and part of mine, and then part of the old one and part of mine, and they said, holy smoke, the old one's slow. So we had accomplished what we wanted, and that was to make it fast.
What? Well, I got a disc I want to move. Never mind what.
Hildy.
What the deuce do you want?
Oh, hello, Bruce.
Hildy.
No, never mind the Chinese earthquake, for heaven's sake.
Hildy, I just want to ask you one question.
Bruce, how did you get out of jail?
Well, not through any help of yours.
Now, listen, buddy, you can't come in
here.
We're busy.
I had to wire Albany for
your comedies make fun of the professional man. Where, you know, Cary Grant is a paleontologist and bringing up baby and a scientist in monkey business, and Rosalind Russell is a newspaper woman. In a sense, you make fun of another kind of profession, you know.
Well, that comes from not choosing an obviously comic character. We've done that a couple of times. We did with Cary Grant in Bringing Up the Baby. But at the same time, he was a professional. But so many times you do it just because it gets away from the usual comedy viewpoint of where they pick an obvious character and say, this man's going to be funny. Mm-hmm. Then you start off with two strikes against you. You're a whole lot better starting, as Cary Grant did in Oh, I Was a Male War Bride, as a very serious French officer.
Yeah.
Who walked in and somebody said, we need an interpreter. And Cary said, you don't need an interpreter. I can speak English, Sergeant. And then his troubles came because of his meeting Ann Sheridan. And that becomes a comedy.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to know the details of my assignment in order to know what equipment to draw from the quartermaster.
See if they have a spare head.
And I may as well warn you, Bubble Mouth, I'm going to carry a revolver and a trench knife. And if you so much as lay a finger on me this trip, you're going back to France minus a lot of parts you probably value.
Which of your films do you think, of all the many films you've made, do you think you like best or you remember with the most affection?
I think probably Scarface. We made it in a time when we couldn't borrow anybody from a studio because we were independents. We went into a little dust-covered studio and opened it up, and we were an entity unto ourselves. We made a picture. And almost everybody in the crew acted in it, and there was no one in it that had any prominence at all. Muni was at the theater at 39th Street in New York playing an old man. Anne Dvorak was a chorus girl at Metro Golden, and George Raft I saw at a prize fight. And we just collected actors and went ahead and made it. And the whole thing was a challenge and a lot of fun, especially to have it turn out very well and become a kind of a legend.
Yeah, little boy. Easy dough, eh, for just standing outside and listening to a gun go off.
Cinch, when are we going to get some more?
We get plenty.
This business is just waiting for some guy to come and run it right. And I got ideas.
Listen, little boy. In this business, there's only one law you got to follow to keep out of trouble. Do it first. Do it yourself. And keep on doing it.
In Scarface, all the faces of the gangsters really looked like gangsters. They didn't look like extras, you know. They weren't movie faces at all.
Property men, wardrobe men, things like that. Everybody played a part.
Yeah. Were you in it? I didn't see it.
I was the man on the bed that was spread-eagled in the form of a cross, just with his underwear on.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
With the Karloff?
No, and on those X marks, the spot dissolves.
Oh. The restaurant scene when he gets the machine gun, there's an exhilaration to that when he uses the machine gun. There's that great line, get out of the way, Johnny, I'm going to spit.
Yeah, that's one of the greatest lines in the movie.
I'm going to write my name all over this town with it in big letters.
Hey, stop him, somebody.
Get out of my way, Johnny, I'm going to spit.
Muni didn't think he could play that kind of a character. But he was such a great actor that he could play anything.
Mm-hmm.
He wore a special padded coat. He walked on planks this high through all the scenes. He was up with the small men. George Raft was small. What's his name was small?
Perkins.
Perkins. I never put him with a big man.
Just to make him look bigger.
Sure, I had to make him look tall, strong and tough. Yeah. He's completely sedentary, you know. He can't do anything.
Where'd the idea come from that Muni starts whistling when he's going to kill somebody?
We knew we were going to use the record, Crusoe records and the famous operas and things, so we decided to use that piece. And it's a very easy one to go with, and so we just put whistling with it.
Uh-huh. What record thing do you mean? You mean when he breaks the records?
No. What was the music that was playing when?
At the beginning?
Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
Isn't that it?
Something like that, yeah.
Just something like it, because I can't stay on tune.
At the end of Scarface, there's a dialogue piece. I think she says, "Why didn't you shoot?" He says, "You're me, I'm you. It's always been that way." Something like that. And you give the impression that even though he's trapped in this room, all alone, I mean, trapped in this room, he's obviously not going to live through this.
And during the final scene of the picture, Muni, he was going to play the scene where he came downstairs and was yellow, like an actor being yellow, not play it for honesty. And I talked to him about it, and he did it the same way. So I went off and started a game of poker. And he began to get more and more fidgety, and finally he came over and said, "When are we going to do the scene?" I said, "Whenever you decide to do it, the way it should be done." About 5 minutes later, he came over and said, "Okay, you can do it. I'll do it." And he really played the devil out of it.
No! Don't shoot! Don't shoot, Carino! Look at Garino, I'm all alone. I got no gun, see? Give me a break, will you, Garino?
Break? Who'd you ever give a break to?
Look, I got nobody. I'm all alone. This little boy's gone. Angelo's gone. My steel shutters don't work.
Shut up! Come down.
Sure, I took
that. How did you decide, what made you decide to go into movies?
I worked during summer vacation at Paramount Studio. And they interested me, and I got started in them and stayed in them after I got out of college.
Mm-hmm. Were there any particular people, any particular directors or writers, I would say directors probably, who influenced you in the early days? Or
I worked with a man who was a great influencer, Marshall Nealon. He made a great many of the early Mary Pickford pictures, and he made he had a very fertile, inventive mind and a great sense of humor. And almost everything that I learned about comedy, I began to learn from him. He had a great deal of influence on me. later on.
Hmm. He was your main influence then in directing?
Yes, lately, in latter years. My favorite directors have been men that I could go to see their pictures and learn something, like John Ford, Billy Wilder, Victor Fleming, who made Gone with the Wind, who's now dead, and I enjoyed very much working with Ernst Lubitsch, and I learned a lot from him.
Did you work with, you worked with him at Paramount?
I worked with him at Paramount as more or less a producer.
What would you say was your definition of good direction?
I think so. Somebody who doesn't annoy you. There are very few of them that can do tell you a whole story and not annoy you. Best thing to do is to tell a story as though you're seeing it. Tell it, you know, from your eyes and let the audience see it exactly the way they would if they were there. The camera, we rarely get the camera into strange places. Just tell it normally.
Well, thank you very much. That's it.
Cut.
If you've been enjoying The Plot Thickens, why not give us a rating or review? And tell a friend about us, too. We really appreciate it. See you next time.